So whoever you are, wherever you're from, wherever you are on life's journey, you are so welcome here. And we are students learning how to love with courage, compassion, and the conviction of acting in nonviolent ways for justice, for all people, for all life. That is why we're here together. So I invite those of you who are new or especially quiet to sign in on the Welcome and Concerns form. If you have a special prayer request, it goes just to the pastor. Or if you're here with us for the first time, there's a PewPad divine document that's in the bulletin that's in the chat, so you can fill that out. And so we're reminded as this one body that each one of us has a body. And so move whatever needs to be moved. Stretch your arms up to the heavens like a tree. And also thinking of the tree to be deeply rooted and grounded in the earth. Hug yourself, hug the person next to you, or if you have a pet with you or whatever. And in this time of hugging and loving, let us have the courage to be fully present, fully human, fully open to the burning bushes, to the light, the inbreaking of God, to our consciousness being broken open, to God's presence, which is everywhere and within everyone, calling us to our deepest calling, to return home, to love God, to love everyone as neighbor, even our enemies, and to love ourselves. Amen. And we will now hear our opening hymn, Ken Medema.
Yes. Friends, singing is something that we do together. And it's difficult to do that on Zoom, but we're going to try. And it's going to sound a little bit crazy, but the joy about this is that we will hear each other's voices. This hymn has three verses. And on the last verse, which begins, friends of God and friends of Jesus, friends of journey, friends of peace, we want all of us to sing together. We want to be unmuted so that we can hear each other's voices. And even though it sounds like a bit of a jumble, mm-hmm. The joy is that we will hear each other's voices. So I'll sing the first two verses, and then we'll sing that last verse together. Sisters, brothers, come together for this time of hope and rest. See and hear and know each other, each one blessing, each one blessed. Hear this time for talk and silence in this gentle place apart. Time to work and wait and wonder, food for body, mind, and these moments, fearing that we might be known, longing for a sweet communion, feeling being while so alone. Let pretend
be broken, to be human, let us dare. Let the truth in love be spoken. Let us now the question share.
You know the tune? Be brave. Take a deep breath. Let's try this. Friends of God and friends of Jesus. Friends of God and friends of Jesus. Friends of journey, friends of peace. We have come to friend each other. Come to rest, renew peace. God of human transformation. For your presence now we pray. Lead us ever on the journey as we gather here today.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for lifting up your voices, everyone. And now, hear this prayer of confession adapted from Romans chapter 12, 19 through 21. Kindled in the fire of God's love, let us consider questions inspired by the Apostle Paul. Is our love always genuine? Do we resist evil? Do we faithfully serve God? Are we hospitable to strangers? Do we bless our enemies? Are we close with those who are different from us? Do we seek revenge upon those who have wronged us? Please join me, out loud but muted, in the unison prayer of confession that is printed in your bulletins. God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that our love isn't always genuine, that we seek evil and wring our hands instead of resisting it. We forget to consider more ways to serve you. We turn our back on strangers who could benefit from our hospitality. We do not pray enough for our enemies. We associate with our own kind, fearing the other. We relish in fantasies of revenge. For all this, and for all that burdens our heart today, O God, we seek your forgiveness. Have mercy on us and hear our prayers. Let us hold the silence briefly. Hear these words of assurance. God's infinite mercy extends beyond our collective imagination. God's love seeps through every wall we ever put up. God's goodness holds more power than the sum of all wrongs. And so in that extensive, seeping, powerful, and bold love, the God of being and becoming illuminates us, forgives us, inspires us, and is with us in who we are and in who we are called to become. Amen. We will now hear the music for preparation. Moses, Ken Medema.
Oh, Moses, way back there in the wilderness, saw some smoke, came to the bush, and the bush was burning. God said, take off your shoes, Moses, 'cause you're on holy ground. Moses, I've chosen you to be my man. Moses, over there in Egypt land. Moses, I've chosen you to work for me. Moses, I'm gonna set my people free. Not me, God. Don't you know I can't talk so good? I stutter all the time. Do you know my brother Aaron? He can sing like an angel, talk like a preacher. Not me, Lord. Can't talk so good. And another thing, how will they know that I've been here with you? How will they know what you've sent me to do? But you know in Egypt they want little Moses' head. But you know in Egypt they want little Moses dead. But you know they'll never hear a single word I say. Maybe you better get your dirty work done another way. Not me, God. Not me, God. Yes, you, Moses. For you are the one. You are the way to do what must be done. This is your day. This is the time, and you say it's the wrong time. This is the way, but you think it's the wrong way. You are the person, but you think you're the wrong person to do what's calling to be done. But life is what happens to you when you're making other plans. And if you wait until those plans are made, life will slip right through your hands. This is the time, and it may be the right time. Oh, Moses, this is the way, and it might be the right way. You are the person, and you're the right person to do what's calling to be done.
Amen. Hear these words from the book of Exodus, chapter 3, verses 1 through 14. From the New International Version. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And there the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. And when the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. And then God said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. And so, go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be a sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. And Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and they say to them, the God of your father has sent me to you, and they ask me, and what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. I am becoming who I am becoming. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. So ends our reading. We will now hear another music for preparation.
And the centuries go by. And just as Moses went down to Egypt, we see another man with a small group of followers, and he's walking toward Jerusalem. And maybe he's thinking just like Moses thought. But you know, in Jerusalem, they want little Jesus' head. But you know, in Jerusalem, Lord, they want little Jesus dead. You know, in Jerusalem, they'll never hear a word I say. Maybe you better get this labor done another way, not me. Let this cup pass from me, if you will. But I will go, for this is the time. And I know it's the right time. This is the way, and I know it's the right way. I am the person, and I'm the right person to do what's calling to be done. And life is what happens to me. I wish there were another plan. I can't wait till other plans are made. Now this task is in my hand.
This is the time, and I know it's the right time. This is the way, and I know it's the right way. This is the moment, I know it's the right moment to do what's crying to be done.
Amen. And our second reading, the gospel reading for this morning, comes from the gospel according to Matthew, chapter 16, verses 21 through 26 in the NIV, continuing from last week's theme where Jesus asks a courageous question about his own identity. If you remember, he asks his disciples, "Who do others say that I am?" And they say, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, Moses. And then he says, "But you, who do you say that I am?" And Peter proclaims, "You are the Messiah." And Jesus declares, "Peter, you are a rock. And upon this rock, I will build my church." So our reading continues this morning. And so from that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. "Never, Lord," he said, "this shall never happen to you." Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." And then Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me will find it. For what good will it be if someone gains the whole world yet forfeits their soul?" Let us meditate on these words in the sanctuary of our hearts and minds. Please pray with me. Come, Holy Spirit. Fill our hearts, kindle us in the fire of your love, send forth your spirit, that we may all be renewed, and you shall renew the face of the earth. Amen. Do you remember all those wonderful bedtime stories you heard over and over again as a child, comforting you with tales of how they all lived happily ever after, lulling you into a restful night's sleep? Well, have you ever read a well-known, beloved bedtime story to a child and then changed the ending just to see what they do? Like, and then Santa Claus came down the chimney and he took all the toys of the children. He went back up the chimney and then he burned the house down. Any of you ever do that? Maybe it was just me. Because you know what the kids are going to say. They are going to protest loudly. "Hey, that's not how the story goes. Santa gives all those children the toys. He loves the children. He keeps them safe." We do the same thing with a friend when a friend is trying to describe a Disney children's movie plot and is completely botching it up. "Hey, that's not how the story goes. Bambi doesn't get killed. Simba doesn't get killed. He becomes the Lion King. It's a happy ending." We cry out with exasperation and then we leap in and we try to do it better. This is not unlike what happens to Peter. He knows the story of the Messiah, or he thinks he knows the story of the Messiah. He was brought up on it. He knows the whole plot by heart. First, a warrior king will rise up. He'll be hailed as the son of David and the son of man. He will rally the children of Israel, head their armies, and with God's help, he will drive those Roman swine back to whatever pigsties they crawled out of, freeing Israel from foreign domination and tyranny, restoring home rule, and making the law of God once more the law of the land. And they all lived happily ever after. The end. That's how the story is supposed to go anyway. So Peter might be excused when, as Jesus starts telling the story and telling it differently, that Peter objects. In essence saying, Jesus, you're telling it all wrong. There's nothing in the story about the Messiah undergoing great suffering and the Messiah being killed. That's not part of the story. And then there's this bizarre being raised from the dead prediction. That's not part of the story for sure. Not only that, but this is supposed to be a story of triumph and victory. But Jesus seems hell-bent on making this story into a tragedy. Peter loves Jesus. And Jesus's version of this story is not only not the way it's supposed to go, according to Peter, but Peter has a significant emotional investment in it not going that way. No wonder he says, God forbid it. This must never happen to you. We give Peter a lot of grief. He goes from rock to stumbling block to get behind me, Satan. But he's really a stand-in for us. Who among us would respond differently? If there's one person in this story I can relate to, it's Peter. The scenario isn't unique to Jesus, of course, or to Peter, of course. We tend to object whenever things don't go according to our plan, especially when it involves our own lives, and especially when it involves suffering, sacrifice. Take Moses, for example. His life didn't unfold as he expected, not even close. Remember, he was a Hebrew baby who was set adrift on a basket floating in the Nile River. And he's swept up and adopted into the household of Pharaoh. He becomes prince of Egypt, living in the lap of luxury. Who, in the heat of passion one day, lashes out at an act of injustice. Remember, he saw an Egyptian soldier whipping a Hebrew slave, and it pulled on his heart with compassion. And he finds that in the space of a heartbeat, his status has changed from privileged prince to a murderer and a wanted man. And so Moses flees, he runs for his life. He flees, goes to the desert to hide out in the wilderness from the authorities. He runs for his life, leaving behind a part of himself, a part of his home, a part of his integrity, a part of his people. And his life took a big, unexpected detour. And I'm sure Moses must have objected. That's not how the story was supposed to go. But then there's more. Life goes on. Moses falls in love. He meets a girl. He settles down. He's working for his father-in-law Jethro, tending sheep. But then the plot twists again. Moses is about to be surprised again. Tending sheep one day, Moses encounters a strange sight. A bush is burning, but it's not being burned up. And accompanying this bush is a voice claiming to be the God of his ancestors, a litany of his ancestors. Moses didn't see this coming, nor did he expect what happened next, that God commands him to go back to Egypt, where he is a wanted man, remember, to confront the most powerful person on earth, Pharaoh, and to demand the release of Egypt's most prized possession and its economic engine, its slave labor. Moses' initial response was not much different from Peter's. God forbid it. This must never happen to me. Please, God, ask someone else. This is not how the story is supposed to go. It's not different for us. When we're young, we have ideas about how our life should go, what our story is supposed to look like, and what God is supposed to be. And then we say, wait a minute, this wasn't what it was supposed to be like. This wasn't my plan. We weren't supposed to get old or sick or die or have our hearts broken, but we do. 180,000 people in this country weren't supposed to die of COVID, but they did. Racism was supposed to be over, but it isn't. Santa wasn't supposed to run away with the toys, but he did. This was not the way the story was supposed to go. Jesus rebukes Peter, and it's harsh. We're going to let that go because Jesus is going through a lot right now, and everyone gets to have a bad day. But look at what he says to Peter. Peter, you are focusing on human things, not divine things. Okay, so Jesus might get a D for how he says it, get behind me, Satan. But what he says is A plus material. He's inviting Peter to shift his perspective, to step back and take a God's eye view, the long view, the wider view, the more inclusive, connected view, rather than to look at his own little life, to realize that none of us are free until all of us are free. A God 5.0 view. According to this story, God is the God of the oppressed, calling forth liberators who are willing to sacrifice with courageous love for the greater good of all people, with the promise, I will be with you through it all. But here in this country, according to our nationalistic story, our God is the God of the rugged individual, promising that anyone can make it if they work hard enough and they play by the rules and are willing to pull themselves up by the bootstraps. It's a lie. It's a myth, as old as the pharaohs and Caesars, and it's alive and well in the tyrants of our times. The old strategy, keep power by keeping the slaves fighting amongst themselves for the scraps. This is how pharaohs and Caesars and tyrants keep their power, including using religion to justify exploitation, slavery, imprisonment, conquests, fear-mongering, hatred, and genocide, all in the name of God. God, I believe, is calling us beyond this myth of the rugged individual, beyond this myth of being a uniquely chosen people, to migrate to a new land, to a new faith, to become a new being, to become a people of great diversity, embracing that diversity, united in love, remembering the suffering of all of our brothers and sisters. I believe that God is calling us to set them free so that we too may be free. God is calling us together through the power of love to challenge the pharaohs of our time, to make something beautiful out of the broken wreckage of our world and of our lives. And I believe that God is calling us to move beyond the fear of death into eternal life right now with God's promise. I am with you and I will be with you. I am who I am, and I am becoming who I am becoming, and so are you. And you and I and all of us, we are in this together. Amen. We will now hear the sermon response. Ken.
We're in this together. There's a little chorus that goes like this.
I hear the music and it's calling me. Come and be all that you were born to be. If anybody would come after me. Take up your cross and follow. Just real simple like that. I hear the music and it's calling me. Come and be all that you were born to be. If anybody would come after me, take up your cross and follow. See when it comes around. Can you hear it down the ages? Like the ringing of a bell. A call to leave the night and step into the morning. It's a call to joy and gladness in a world of war and pain. And yet it sounds a note of danger and a warning. It's a call to leave your treasures and your trinkets on the road. A call to join the weeping and to bear the sufferer's load. It's a call to live like fools by another set of rules. Call to take your cross in hand and follow. Here's our chorus. I hear the music and it's calling me. Come and be all that you were born to be. If anybody would come after me, take up your cross and follow. It's a call to love the stranger. It's a call to live as friends in a world that says good fences make good neighbors. It's a call to face the makers of destruction and of war and to plead that we put down those guns and sabers. Joy and gladness. It's a call to joy and to peace. It's a call to live like fools by another set of rules. Well, it's a call to take your cross in hand and follow. It's a joyful expectation of the dawning of that day when God shall write the final chapter in the story. It's a call to be the lowly. It's a call to be the least. It's a call to join the fasting that shall lead to a final feast. It's a call to live like fools by another set of call to take your cross in hand and follow. Here's our chorus. I hear the music and it's calling me. Come and be all that you were born to be. If anybody would come after me, take up your cross and follow.
My friends, it is time to lift up our prayers. And again, I want to lift up the beautiful Psalm 139 as our centering. O God, you have searched me and you know my ways. You perceive all my thoughts from afar. Your hand is upon me wherever I go. Before I form each word, you already know. God, our sanctuary, gather us. God, who speaks to us through burning bushes, who kindles the fire in our hearts, awaken us to the cries of your people. your people who are fleeing the wildfires in Northern California and the hurricanes in Louisiana and Texas and the tsunamis and droughts in the world. Awaken us with compassion to respond to their needs in the short term. Awaken us to fight to give voice to the truths of science. Deliver us from the deadly bondage of unregulated greed and profiteering that contributes to global warming and the destruction of life. God, may we hear the cries of your people, those dying of COVID or other illnesses, all those who are separated at this time from loved ones. Deliver us from politicians who censor science and value their own reelection more than human life. God, who awakens us to the cries of your people, awaken us to the cries of yet another unarmed Black man, 29-year-old Jacob Blake, father of three, who is paralyzed. Awaken us to the hatred of those who would shoot protesters. Liberate us from racism in criminal justice systems and the proliferation of assault weapons distributed to minors. God, our guardian, protect physicians and nurses and firefighters and teachers and parents. God, our shelter, protect all who are struggling to find work or pay rent or buy food or pay for medical care. God of empowerment, strengthen us all to end voter suppression and exclusion from the census, inspired by that same spirit that inspired John Lewis. God of everlasting arms, we give you thanks. Celebrate the birthday of Tony Pegram today, Gabrielle Lockhart. God of everlasting arms, we give thanks, remembering this past week, the 1-year anniversary of the birth of Will Ang since his passing. We give thanks for Sheila Helms, who once more was in the hospital, that she is being cared for and recovering. We give thanks for the circle of friends who are there for one another. Are there other prayers at this time? You can type them into the chat. From David Garrett, Claude is scheduled for an epidural on Wednesday to treat his back pain. May it go well. Be successful. Are there other prayers? All right, then let us bring our prayer, continued prayers for Dave Byrons as he recovers from his third degree burns, that he is compassionate and patient with himself in the healing process. Let us join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Creator, Mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And so this morning, in addition to our regular offering, we want to lift up again the relief efforts for people who have needed to evacuate or are recovering after the California fires and after Hurricane Laura. And further down in your bulletins, you'll see some recommended sources from Charity Navigator. So we encourage you to please give generously to our brothers and sisters in need. And we will now hear this morning's song of giving and closing, Holy Ground by Ken Medema. So my friends, before the blessing, I want to encourage you to join us for our continuing conversation of Brian McLaren's The Great Spiritual Migration. After the blessing and the postlude, we'll have about 15 minutes before that conversation starts to talk about the sermon. Love to have your questions, observations, thoughts. Tom Manley will be facilitating. This week, we continue the discussion about the great theological migration from a God of violence to a nonviolent God of liberation and love for all people, all creation. And so in this blessing, I want us to do something different. I realize a lot of you are sitting, myself included, but if you're comfortable, if you're able to do this, I invite you to take off your shoes and your socks. And I invite you to stand up. I'm doing the same thing. I have my shoes and socks off. Let's see, I wanna make sure we can. Can you see me? Let me see, speaker view. Stand, I want us to stand on holy ground. Are you standing? I see some puzzled expressions. Let's see, because there's something about standing on ground. We are grounded in the earth. Our feet, it's skin to skin. It's intimate. We're connected with this earth. We are part of the earth. And take a moment and stand in silence. And hear these words as we go forth. May we perceive God's surprising presence, kindling a fire within us, calling us into a new being, calling us into the wilderness and through the refining fires, and assuring us, I am with you and I will be with you through it all. We are in this together, calling us to become strong servant leaders, liberators, hope, comfort, compassion, love, justice, and life for all people and all creation. Amen. Okay, our postlude. Amen.